Tanzania Transit now is my second feature-length documentary. My first one was Wafumba, also shot in Kenya. This one was Tanzania, but East Africa is more my theme of where my films are from. It's also because my father's been living 35 years in Kenya, so I grew up a long time in Kenya, and I've also traveled and worked in Tanzania a lot. So that's where I get my inspiration to make my films. My films I made before, they were really about personal stories, characters that inspired me, strong people that have a strong story to tell. With this film, I wanted to make a more general film about East Africa, and I wanted to give the viewer a sense of what it is this huge country is struggling through in this modern times and how fast everything's changing. And I found a couple of people which I wanted to make a portrait film about. So the film is a little bit of a collage film of three characters put together. They represent, I think, a global picture of what is going on in different parts of society. And so this film is really a glimpse of society. And I wanted to find a way to put them all together and kind of have a setting that would give the impression of that we were there in the society. And the train for me was a representation of like a microcosm of East Africa. I think how women are struggling in a very male-dominated country, there is a lot of changes happening. And of course, the film portrays Hukia and her story about how she was sold as a young girl, all the devastating things she's had to endure because of horrible men in her life. It's a film also very much about hope and about strength, female strength, and how women are coming together and not accepting this anymore, and how changes are happening now on a very fast moving pace. I think in the past years, we've always had presidents and political figures that are there not for the people, but for themselves. And you do notice now and again, people are there wanting to make a change for humanity, for their culture. And this standing up, fighting for other people's rights, you're seeing it more and more, and I would love to see that Kenya and Tanzania will change their ways, that politicians will stand behind their people, that women will have the right to vote, to own property, and to send their girls to school just like boys, and to have a more equal country for all nationals. We've seen like Kenya and Tanzania having very stable economies in the last 30 years. So East Africa has been actually very stable in the past 20, 30 years. But this instability is always playing a major factor. And because of this, I think people are very reluctant to invest except for foreign investments. So what you're finding now is, because there's a lot of gas and oil and resources found in Tanzania and in Kenya, especially in the ocean now, there's a lot of firms doing geographical studies for gas mining in the Indian Ocean. This is going to change the whole landscape along the East African coastline. And all the gas and oil that they're finding now in Lake Tanganyika and in the desert, where the train also moves through, it's gonna change. And the thing is, all the rights have already been sold or up for highest bids, and that's all not within the country itself. So what a country does, I think politicians do, is they sell the rights. Any rights they have to sell, they will sell them. And the money goes straight in their pockets. So it doesn't go to a treasury bank of the country itself, which is then dispersed along the people's needs. It goes into their own pockets. And 4 years later, there's a new politicians, and the rights get taken back into their hands and are resold again. So this this is, I think, how I keep hearing how property, farming rights, fishing rights, mining rights, that's how a lot of these politicians make big, big money, and selling literally all the value of the nation's value without the nation actually having anything for it in return. The Chinese have been in Kenya along the coastline since I was there, so since I remember. I can only give you kind of all the, I know where all the mines are and I know why they're there, which companies, but it's all very hush-hush. Like, it's the only time it's on the news is because the Chinese build a bridge or lay a railroad, because the politicians themselves don't do it. So the Chinese say, look, if we pay you money to build a bridge, but you don't pay it, you put the money in your pocket, then we will build the bridge ourselves, because we need the bridge, otherwise our company cannot function. And so you hear all this, these Chinese are building actually infrastructure, but it's because of their own benefits. I think it's catastrophic, really, how crazy it is that in the near future, all the farming lands are bought up by Russian investors and Saudi Arabia, because they have no place to grow their own vegetables. So they buy up huge areas in Africa of delta farming lands, and they build big mines for precious metals. And they make deals in such a way that they can own this land or rent this land for hundreds of years, and the government and their people afterwards will not actually make any money from it. And so it's stealing, and yeah, it's stealing the country dry. So East Africa is a very stable area, and Sudan, Ethiopia, and Congo have a lot of war. So you have a lot of refugees and migrants coming over to look for peace. And you do notice that at all the capital cities like Nairobi. There's much less and less land. I mean, this is crazy to think Kenya is one of the biggest countries, and the people are fighting for land. Are really struggling. So there's a lot of war between ethnic groups about agricultural land that can be used to grow their foods. Sure. And I think when you talk about countries like Russia or other big investing countries that are buying up large agriculture areas, that's pushing a lot of pressure on rural communities. Sure, yeah. So they're all either migrating to the cities or maybe moving country. And this problem is going to get much worse and worse, I think, in the future. Yeah.